from this series. My name is Kimberly K. Malone, and I'm one of the librarians here. Show of hands, how many folks have been to a COSI before? Yeah, maybe about half the room. Fantastic. Thank you to the newcomers. Thank you for coming back to the oldies but goodies. So, the library hosts this series every week because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. We want us to all have the opportunity to learn and grow from different perspectives and viewpoints. So whether or not you agree with every single thing you hear in this room or read in our materials outside, we want you to have access to it so that we can learn and grow from each other and expand our worldview. So at the end of this, I'll also fill out a very brief survey asking what you'd like to see in the future, what's important to you. You'll also note that we have a number of materials up here, so if you're interested in learning more about this topic, right? If you're able to check any of these out, the other librarians at the reference desk are also happy to help you find anything else that you'd like. We're not going to have a COSI next week, but the following week we'll have a session on linked fate, race, and political mobilization. That's going to be led by political science faculty Jose Ochoa. But this week, I want you all to give your time and attention and a very warm welcome to our fantastic presenters, Bo, Stephanie, Dr. Valerie Hunt, and January. Please join me in welcoming them and giving them your attention.
So I do want to give folks maybe an extra minute to straggle in. So if you just came in during the introductions, here's a question for you to just think about on your own. Write down your own answer, and then we'll ask you to put those pieces of paper away for a couple of minutes, and we'll get back to them in about 15 minutes. Okay. Does anybody need paper or pen? Of art and civic discourse and belonging, mainly just as a scaffold, as a starting point. And what we hope to spend the rest of this time doing is facilitating your own discussions, your own discoveries, on how you specifically intersect with art, with civic discourse, with belonging, because these are really individual things, right? So I'm just going to start with my own story. I'm Bo. I've been thinking about belonging specifically as it relates to place and change. For the last decade plus in the field of urban planning and affordable housing development and so forth, and belonging is, it's a weird thing to think about in this country, right? This country built on stolen land, and it's my presence here, when I set foot on American soil 30 years ago, was that a perpetuation of that original sin? Or is it somehow a small symbolic victory over six decades of Chinese exclusion that only ended in 1943. You layer in gentrification, layer in change, and it gets really complicated really quickly. So when I step back from all of that for a little bit, the way that I tend to think about belonging these days, and this is just my mental model for now, and other people are free to disagree, and the disagreement is totally encouraged. I've been thinking a lot about belonging in existing in this duality between freedom on one hand and then connection on the other. In other words, we human beings, we long to be connected and we long to be free. And belonging somehow requires both, right? Freedom is like, it's the enoughness that says, I'm enough as I am, I have enough, I don't need your validation, I don't need your help. And connection is kind of the opposite. It's the vulnerability of saying, I'm not enough as I am, and that's why I need you. You can think of it as liberation and inclusion. Somehow belonging is both things. And for a really long time, our society has tried to solve this duality. And, you know, and this has been going on for a long time. Like, my family came here to escape the vulnerability of poverty and find the enoughness of the American dream. But then we came here, and now I've learned a generation later that the middle class in America is, in fact, a very lonely place to be. When you don't, when you have everything you need and you don't need your neighbors, it's hard to feel as weak as yourself. I could also be standing up here and try not to be vulnerable and look silly or stupid, but then that would also be a lovely place to be, to say, I don't actually need anybody else's input or advice, right? So art and civic discourse, for me, are strategies for encompassing that duality, because both art and dialogue, they have that complexity that enables, that can hold both enoughness and vulnerability at the same time. And so what I try to do is catalyze experiences, experiments that help me and hopefully other people experience and kind of think about that sense of the complexity of true belonging. So We the Public last November was an example of that. Basically, it happened in November on the one-year anniversary of the presidential election. And what I wanted it to be was some art-facilitated experience of community to get together, just reflect on what that election was like, what we've learned in the year since, what we haven't learned in the year since. And it became pretty obvious pretty quickly that there's no piece of art that I could create that could hold that entire truth. And so I basically just put out a call for help. And it was just this graphic on Facebook. It just said, November 8th, 2017, 5 to 8:30 p.m. Bring your art, bring your performances on how we talk about politics today. And the result, I hope, was this manifestation of this idea that no piece of art on its own could encapsulate that entire idea, but together, each piece of art was enough, kind of like cells in a human body, where each cell serves a different function, but no cell needs to do any more than it already does, because together the whole is bigger than something else. So, with that, that's not who it is.
Hey, I'm Stephanie, and actually, kind of like Beau, I come at art from an urban planning background and affordable housing, but I also come at it from a dance background. So I've done a lot of dance performance, but also for We the Public, I actually choreographed a piece. And so I think those two, even though urban planning and dance seem like they may not quite go together, kind of at first blush, a lot of what dance is thinking about how you inhabit space and how you kind of are and your posture in that space. And a lot of urban planning is just that, is talking about public spaces and how do we put our built environment up and how does that affect the way that we inhabit those spaces as well. So the piece that I made for We the Public kind of tried to explore the ways that we have conversations with people either that we agree with, that we disagree with, or maybe that we don't even realize that we agree with or disagree with already. So I took some movements that either that I kind of observed of people in conversations with each other, and there are some ways that their movements may mirror each other if they agree with each other. Maybe there are ways that they're very kind of close off, they're like even back to back perhaps. And some ways that people are kind of dancing across each other. So two people doing entirely different movements kind of against the grain of each other and trying to find some way that they can kind of negotiate each other's movements and each other's conversations, which I feel like is kind of the way that conversations can happen, especially online and especially about charged topics like politics, is that you may find two people who think that they're coming to the conversation on totally different ends of the spectrum, but as they sort of talk to each other, there may be a situation where they're talking at each other and they just kind of bounce further and further apart. But if they're really taking the opportunity to listen, and in dance there's a lot of listening, even though there's not typically much speaking, kind of listening to your partner's movements. If you do allow that opportunity to listen, and like Bo said, kind of being vulnerable and acknowledging that maybe you don't know everything, you may find that as you're kind of doing this duet of a conversation, you may find that you have more in common with the other person than you realize. So, that's where I'm coming from. Dance and urban planning. Another thing about that is just about how we inhabit space, but also the spaces that we inhabit. So one of the things that I thought was really cool about We the Public was that it was based in Westlake Park. Which, when you think about Westlake Park, it's maybe you would go to lunch there, you kind of walk through there, going to the bus. There are a lot of different things that happen there, but a dance performance is maybe not one of those things that you would think of to happen there. So that's another thing that I'm kind of interested in, is how can we inject art into spaces, especially public spaces, that people don't really think about as an art space. It's not really a theater, it's not a gallery, but it is open to everyone.
I have been writing poetry since I was about five years old, and I found that it was a place where I could be myself and be something else. And I also found that it gave me a lens into being able to look into the depth of racism, which was very much a part of my life when I growing up in the segregated South, where when I would leave in the morning to leave where my family and everyone who was black would go across the railroad tracks to be where the schools were, where commerce was, where everything, where employment was. And so poetry helped me to be able to live that duality of, as you call it, freedom, and not having freedom, and connection. Because that freedom would be assaulted every day, and those connections had to be made every day. And so I found that poetry would allow for that to happen for me. And so I am a political scientist, and the reason why I became a political scientist is because I always wanted to know what it meant to belong on the planet and to be on the planet. My studies are in immigration. I'm always interested in belonging in terms of what citizenship can mean, but it's just an empty word if we don't really get to be fully human in whatever those spaces and places are. And so, as an artist, and I have my artist legs on today, I believe that education is liberation. And for people of darker color, education has always been the place where once you know, you can't unknow. And then you get to be the mistress and the master of not only your own fate, but the fate of your community. And then you get to transform those spaces of oppression. Because once you know, you can't unknow. So I'm actually making t-shirts for spring that say, no means no. So when we have, what's it called? Unity Fair? Mm-hmm. Come and get them at cost. I'm not making any money. And so our sister Audre Lorde says, without community, there is no liberation. And our other sister, Margaret Atwood, says, a word after a word after a word is power. And so when I got the call about We the Public, I wanted to bring, I thought, civic discourse? Wow, that's what we're missing. And what we're missing as human beings is how to be civil with each other. But we have to interrogate what it means to not be civil. So I'm going to read a poem that y'all just heard earlier this week. I don't read my own poetry in front of folks because sometimes I think that's arrogant. But I do in other spaces, but I want to read this one about we are not responsible. We are not responsible by Harriet Mullen. We are not responsible for your lost or stolen relatives. We cannot guarantee your safety if you disobey our instructions. We do not endorse the causes or claims of people begging for handouts. We reserve the right to refuse service to anyone. Your ticket does not guarantee that we will honor your reservations. In order to facilitate our procedures, please limit your carrying on. Before taking off, please extinguish all smoldering resentments. If you cannot understand English, you will be moved out of the way. In the event of a loss, you better look out for yourself. Your insurance was canceled because we can no longer handle your frightful claims. Our handlers lost your luggage, and we are unable to find the key to your legal case. You were detained for interrogation because you fit the profile. You are not presumed to be innocent if the police have reason to suspect you are carrying a concealed wallet. It's not our fault you were born wearing a gang color. It is not our obligation to inform you of your rights. Step aside, please, while our officer inspects your bad attitude. You have no rights we are bound to respect. Please remain calm, or we can't be held responsible for what happens to you. So I live my life to address each and all of these with my poetry and with the work that I do. I'm really blessed to be an educator, and I take it very seriously. And so working with these women's and more women's and men's that are not here, that we don't see, but we bring them with us, has been a privilege because we intend to interrogate civic space and make it a place where it's truthful and in love and with love for what we do. So thank you.
Hello everyone, I'm Amy Ray Fredericks, and I am here. I met these wonderful people. I met Bo in a group that I run, a co-host with a few other women here in Seattle called Seattle Salon for Social Justice. It's open to the public, so if anyone ever wants to come and talk, that's our goal, is just to get together and talk about whatever topic in the public for that month. Why am I here? You know, I'm like, there's all these amazing people around doing all these amazing things, and I guess I'm here because that has been sort of my place in this, is I grew up in the South. I grew up in a very conservative Republican family, and I got away from that, and I almost feel like this guilt that I have to kind of undo a lot of the damage I've seen in the community I came from. So my goal is to uplift other voices, to support other people whose voices might not be heard. I'm a photographer, and so that is how I lend my art form. I try to cover events for people. I offer volunteer time for organizations. So for the public, I said, I came from a job in tech, and I was a product manager, so I had to organize things, and I could do that, just throw stuff at me. So, they gave me the job of organizing all the artists and, coordinating and things like that, and it's really something I never really thought I had the skills for. I can't go set up an art show. I don't know anything about that. But coming together with people that, it's not about what we know, it's about what we want to do and how we want to put our energy out into the world and what we want to spend our time on doing. So for me, the reason that myself and two others started the discussion group was because we were so frustrated and just kind of heartbroken on how people talk to each other online. And we said, gosh, it's so great. Like, we're now, all these communities are coming together and we're all face-to-face online talking, but we're not really hearing each other. There's a lot of noise, there's a lot of animosity, there's a lot of anger, and all of that is very valid. But how do we move past that? So I am interested in getting people face-to-face in any capacity and having hard conversations when we need to, and figuring out how to move forward.
So at this point, what I'd like you to do is turn to somebody next to you and talk a little bit, and talk about whatever you heard us talk about, and also your own response to this question here. We'll give you about 10 minutes to do that.
I'm not going to be able to do that.
To let us know that you're not comfortable with that, so you don't have to announce it to the room. Thank you so much. Please continue your conversation.
So the art
I'm going to be there.
If you want to make your own, you can have your own.
Exclusion or belonging depending on who's seeing it. And, you know, we also talked about how, like, say, representation is also tied to, you know, gentrification, you know, when you talk about urban planning, and, you know, how that, you know, how that, like, changes, you know, the picture of what the neighborhood.
Thank you. What else?
Well, I tied into or connected with art that's just, well, that represents a different, that represents a social problem. I was thinking of something that Tatiana created about homelessness. It was down in one of the municipal buildings. And so, you know, there it was. It was a tent, and then some of it was sort of abstract. And so that gets one thinking about, you know, right? You know, there's nothing abstract about the topic.
Right. And not to, that, I hope this isn't putting anybody on the spot, but like, of the pieces of art you mentioned, is there any action or any thought in this particular that it opened up for you after you see that art?
Well, not for me personally, because I work with agencies in the community that deal with homelessness, so it's not something, I'm very aware of, and I'm aware of the dynamics and the humanness of the people involved and all that kind of stuff. However, what I did think about when I saw that was, wow, this is great that this is in a public space. And it was actually in a window. I mean, we couldn't even get inside that day. It was like Sunday or something. And I thought, okay, people can't ignore this. You know, they're going to see it, and they may say, you know, any number of things. Oh, the homeless people, those people. Are, but I think they'll have to go beyond that.
So I was, we didn't actually need to talk about this, but we were about to get there. I was thinking about the art that was displayed at the Seattle Art Museum by Kende Wiley last year. And while his art is phenomenal, one. And two, it made me really sad when I thought about the number of folks who were there and compared to that to the number of people that I see at like the Northwest African American Museum and the phenomenal art and conversations that happen there, but because it's not, I don't know, because it's not in a place that people think to go as like a place for culture, other than maybe Black people in the United, the Northwest and other people who are interested in Black history and the Black experience, it was just completely, that museum is so underutilized and underappreciated. So it made me think about like the selective conversations about identity that happen and people are willing to engage in, and comparing that with other conversations that continue to happen that people aren't as willing to engage in.
Kind of like that curiosity to get off your front porch in a way.
Yes. Just a little addition to that that's not necessarily related to art, but so town. I was at some Vietnam when Town Hall held something. I mean, not the only time I've been there, but a Town Hall program was held there, and Town Hall is under renovation right now. So they're holding things in different parts of the community, and I think that's a way to. I mean, I love Town Hall, but I really like this idea of things being in various communities and drawing people who wouldn't necessarily go to that community and having discussions about art, politics, civic.
What are some ways that might happen? Drawing people to, outside of or
I have some experience with the punk music scene. Believe me, I was brought up classical musician, very straight-laced, didn't understand rock and roll in the 60s, but I did, in the mid-80s, discover the punk scene very much in keeping with my personal anarchist convictions. You know, I'm not the same kind of anarchist as other people, but that's just notification. However, one strategy used by the punk scene is to hold their events, usually music shows, in any kind of humble venue they can get. So I used to think basement shows were because they're so poor and persecuted. But to me, it's the other way around now. You should use what you have first.
Mm-hmm.
as one of the speakers said, using public spaces. Yeah, it's just great to stumble on things.
You know, funny story about public space. So the permit was like $200 and was covered by a city grant. But there was one artist who really wanted to put out kind of open flame propane pits. To kind of just experiment with what happens when you make the fire bigger or make the fire smaller. Does the circle change? Does the kind of conversation change? And that was just a rabbit hole. Yeah, and we ended up maxing out how much tent space we were allowed without having to pay another $200 for our fire marshal permit and all that sort of thing. So yeah, all these spaces come with their own hairs. What else did people talk about?
What about boring conversations?
What's that?
Boring conversations. If you have if you have no interest in the conversation, how do you deal with that? Do you just keep listening? Or do you just say?
What do people think? Do you have any more example? If you're just stuck in a conversation, you're just
listening.
You're not connecting.
Yeah, okay.
What do you do when you're in a conversation?
Just stay in silence or just leave.
Just listen. Based on several conversations. What else? What else can you do?
You can bring up ideas that matter to you to steer your conversation in the direction you want to go.
So let's call these stuck conversations, right? Because they can be different kinds of stuff. Boring might be one reason, or it could be you could feel like you're not getting anywhere, you're not getting where you want to go. What else?
How about thinking of this kind of conversation in terms of needing to practice a skilled form of consent? You know, I get that term from sexuality, but yeah.
I think that we need to make sure that whoever we're talking to understands what we're saying. Sometimes we have these assumptions that as long as I'm talking, somebody is listening and understanding. But that's not always the truth.
What are some ways to check for understanding?
We can ask. Ask people to tell you what they just heard from you. And if they heard something different than what you intended, there's a point to back up.
Is this along the lines of what the folks were talking about? Are there any things we could talk about stuck conversations, talk about art and strategy? Anything else emerge?
On the tables.
A couple tables we haven't heard anything from yet. What are you talking about then?
One piece of artwork that I saw many years ago, it was very unexpected. I was in Chicago wandering around during a conference and wandered into a museum. It was a beautiful piece of art, a multimedia piece. It was a very historical piece, and it dealt with enslavement. It moved me to begin to think again about history and how I saw history, and even to dig a little bit more into the historical context. I think at one point, the artist used the term Mississippi appendectomy, and that pushed me even further. So art has a catalyst for learning.
So was it kind of that phrase, just having to unwrap the phrase?
The phrase, the feeling, it was a very powerful piece. And just examining what I was feeling and why I was feeling it.
So just kind of curious, show of hands, does anybody here make art, create art? Raise your hand if you do. Does anybody want to share out what kind of art they do? Does any of it relate to belonging or something?
Yes, I think just I keep saying this, but to me, art it's something like not because you gotta paint something. I guess art is just do what you're gonna do. Sometimes we're not like I think it's a good example like you said a moment ago about what with the topic we're talking about is boring, you know. Maybe it's good to deal with it, what about? So most of us, we don't know that's art. So when we think about art, it's just because you got a paint. Mm-hmm. But do example, if you work and you do a table or something, you do, that's part of art. So like if you do something, so whatever you got to do, it's part of art. Everything we do in life, it's part of art. So it's a good to talk about it in conversation.
Can I give you a quote, Reverend, on that one? Can I give you a quote? This quote I read today by a brother named Amiri Baraka, and he says that art is whatever makes you proud to be human. Isn't that a word?
Yeah.
So that's what it sounds like you saying too.
I mean, it's a Thursday, like you say, we never realize it. I'm just realizing it now. It belongs to us. But sometimes we appreciate what we're doing, but it's everything we do is just art.
Well, I think when we take it to public spaces too, that encourages people to feel as if art is around us, part of us and all that, because otherwise people often think of museum equals art in a museum.
Yeah, I have like what we listen to, like music, like that's a form of art.
Thank you. Please join me in thanking our presenters. Any additional time after the session, but if anyone has questions that they'd like to ask or continue the conversation with individual presenters or presenters of the group, you're welcome to continue that in this room. I'm going to hand out the survey. I'm going to ask you to fill it out. It'll literally take you a minute or less.